The views and opinions expressed do not necessarily represent those of Access Fort Wayne, the Allen County Public Library, or any other supporting group. Get involved with Access Fort Wayne and make your own television programming. Call 421-1250 to find out more.
Welcome to the Fort Report. I'm Kevin Leininger, News-Sentinel columnist and reporter. And with me today are State Representative Martin Carbaugh, Republican from Fort Wayne, and Jeff Fusey, who just happens to be one of the leaders of the biggest news story in town the last month, the attempted annexation of about 23 square miles north of Fort Wayne, which a couple of days ago, as we record, went down to defeat at City Council by a 7-2 vote. So today we're going to be exploring why the annexation failed, some of the laws and issues that contributed to that, and then look forward to what, if anything, the state legislature and Mr. Carbaugh might do in the future to address that issue. So before we start, gentlemen, welcome. Thank you for coming. And Jeff, why don't we start with you? How did you and the others in your group first find out about the annexation? From the media, or did you get a heads up?
No, there was no heads up, and I don't even think the city councilman really had a heads up from what I understand. I found out just watching the evening news, and I was quite shocked. I own 40 acres, in the area, and the next couple days I didn't hear anything. I thought there'd be some great opposition to it, so I decided to call a group of the larger landowners and say, we need to do something. If nothing else, from a selfish perspective, is losing our hunting rights, losing our rural property rights. That's what I was mainly worried about. Mm-hmm. And then I think some of the other issues came into play, that I'm sure we'll discuss later, that banded us all together.
Now, you did not know at that point that the schools would be affected?
No.
With West Allen? About $2.5 million in property taxes annually was estimated what they would lose through annexation because of the tax caps that were put in place, 4 or 5 years ago?
Yeah, that's right.
Well, Martin, why don't you explain a little bit about those caps, why they were put in, what the intent was, and what their impact on annexation was in this case? And was it intended to do that, or was that kind of an unexpected development?
Well, this is prior to my time being elected down there, but I'll do my best to kind of review that. You know, tax caps came at a point where property taxes had kind of been set to go way up,
and because of the reassessment ordered by the court,
and people were frustrated by that. We had to find a solution that was workable for our citizens, and so the General Assembly went forward with a plan to put this into the Constitution, the tax caps, the 1-3%, depending upon the type of property.
1% for residential,
right. Yep, 2% business, 3% farm, and so I think, some say it was done in haste and too quick. Well, to amend the Constitution, it's got to pass two duly elected legislatures, and then the citizens of Indiana have to vote. So it was over a long period of time that this came out and this property tax cap happened. Now, were all of the ramifications known at the time? Mm-hmm. I think some probably understood that better than others. The citizens overwhelmingly, though,
80%, voted.
80% of all of our constituents, I like to remind some of my elected official friends, 80% of our constituents voted for this. And so talking to Superintendent Hemsel, it is what we live under.
Mm-hmm. And not likely to change.
I can't imagine that the citizens are going to uncap their taxes. I think that would be and even if it does happen, it's a long process.
But now, Jeff, the impact of that was that not only did the Northwest Allen system stand to lose a lot of money, East Allen, Fort Wayne would have lost less, but still considerable. Allen County would have lost about $5 million total annually in property tax and other things, the library, the airport, the townships. So you put all that together, and that really gave you guys ammunition other opponents of annexation in the past have not had, correct?
Certainly. You know, it was a pretty amazing grassroots organization. We started a Facebook page, and by the end of this, we had 50,000 views the last night, the night, of course, of the vote. So it brought together a group of people, including Superintendent Hemsel, who, of course, had a strong voice in this as well. But it made the city council members listen to us. You know, that was the kind of neat thing about it is, although we weren't really their constituents, you know, they were able to look at the community as a whole, at large, and say, listen, this is going to have some serious negative effects.
Right, although some patrons of the schools were their constituents living within the city limits.
Correct. That's
and
correct.
Obviously the library operates within the city and the airport, and so they did have standing, I think, to get involved, contrary to what some people might have said.
Sure.
Now, I think it was said, if not by you, some of the people in your group, you weren't opposed to annexation per se.
Yeah, I don't like to speak for everyone, but I would say most of us felt that the housing additions where the city had already run out utilities and so forth,
right.
We weren't opposed to those being annexed. At least I wasn't. I don't want to speak for everyone, but you know, we were willing to sit down with the mayor and negotiate, but he was not willing to sit down with us, especially from the beginning. You know, and he spoke the same to the city councilman, saying there is no wiggle room. Mm-hmm. I'm not negotiating. And I think that was part of the problem. It ran down to the end before he was finally willing to negotiate.
And I think as it came out at the city council meeting, when they rolled out the smaller area, and I think you probably would have found it even in the beginning had you gone down that road, it really didn't change the financial picture that much. The schools were still going to lose a lot of money. And so I think that's where the catch-22 comes in with the caps. Even if they had wanted to negotiate, other than maybe keeping everybody more friendly, I'm not sure what it would have mattered in the long run.
No, but I think the mayor and his administration should have looked at that from the beginning. This was no surprise. I mean, that these things were going to happen, that these issues were going to come up. You know, to me and Councilman Crawford brought this up as well. This should have been planned out from the beginning. You know, what was going to be the impact on the schools? How could we possibly help that situation? What could we do for the rural areas? I mean, literally, when I finally did sit down with the city attorney, she said to me, well, what are the issues? Mm-hmm. You know, how could you not see that these issues wouldn't impact us? And how could you not look forward to look at how we could address these issues?
Right. And they said they were willing to talk with you, and they did, I think.
On they did.
Burning,
firearms.
Know, ammunition, noise. But again, that didn't get to the real issue.
No.
So, Martin, maybe while we're on that, looking forward, and I know it's still early to plan next year's session, but you were there the other night, you know, some of the people at the table were kind of trying to throw the blame on you guys for having passed the caps. Do you think that, number
we
one...
We blame on the U.S. government.
Well,
you know,
that a fair, criticism, do you think? And if so, or even if not, do you think anything needs to happen in the years going forward to address this issue, or is it really fine the way it is?
Well, I think that it's fair in that we've got this situation with the tax caps, where transportation funding for our schools and local municipalities, CityLink, you know, they're looking for additional revenue to keep the buses going. We've seen Fort Wayne community cut back to their stated policy. They've
right.
been doing more, but not able to do that anymore. Some communities around the state have seen even more challenges when mm-hmm. it comes to that. So, you know, prior to this, it was already something on the radar. You know, we worked a lot last budget session in 2015 on school funding on a per mm-hmm. pupil basis, try to make that more fair. I think we did a good job, made strides there. But now transportation continues to be an issue that we're going to look at.
But now, if you can't take the caps off, and I think we all agree
yeah,
that's unlikely, and I'm not even sure you should, because
right.
property taxes already make up a pretty good percentage of the budget. Probably don't need to make that bigger, maybe. But if you need to come up with other revenue, what options are there now, or what options do you think might be there moving forward?
Well, options moving forward, I think, is the point of discussion. You know, do we allow different units of government? Do we allow the schools to do a referendum, like we approved a referendum mm-hmm. for repairs to the schools? Do we mm-hmm. do we put in place a referendum for specific transportation funding? I think those are the conversations coming up next year in the budget session, 2017. Is going to have to address those.
Would it have to be a referendum, or would you give them simply the authority to enact it?
We could, you know, when we're making laws, we could.
Property taxes would have to be, but...
Yeah, property taxes. It's unlikely, I think, that property taxes are going to be changed just because of the constitutionality of it.
Although they can go outside the referendum, or outside the levy,
right.
Which was one thing the mayor wanted them to do this time around, and
well,
Superintendent Hensel said, why should we be taxed twice for what we're already getting?
That's right. Yeah, he said, and I was involved in the press conference with other legislators and mm-hmm. school officials at Northwest, and you know, he said, essentially the mayor has said, pay more for what you already get, mm-hmm. what you're already paying for, and mm-hmm. that just did not seem fair, and I definitely agree with that. But I think it would be important, in my mind, to look at the referendum process. You know, people, government should make the case to the people, and the people should mm-hmm. agree and vote for it. I think when it comes to taxation, especially, we got to be careful how we do that. That's what led to the tax caps in the first place.
Right. And to be fair, Fort Wayne passed one this past election.
Yep.
Southwest did. So if you have a good argument to make, you can get it through. Jeff, I think you wanted to speak.
Yeah, you know, if you look at one thing that I've heard over and over again, particularly on the social media and even at the council meetings, is the city really needs to live within their means. Mm-hmm. We all have to do it, and they should as well. I mean, we're looking at $10 million, rough, and I'm talking rough numbers that our area would have brought into the city, mm-hmm. and they were going to fill it with $5 million worth of service, and then the other $5 million was going to go where? We really never got a good answer on that. You know, where exactly is that $5 million going? But I would say definitely the people were overwhelmingly saying, hey, City of Fort Wayne, you need to live within your means and you need to fix what you already have, particularly with the Southwest annexation and even the Northern annexation.
Well, and I should mention, I invited the city to have a representative here today and talk about this with us. They declined, but so I'll play devil's advocate on their part for a little bit.
Sure.
But their argument is, look, you know, we have aging infrastructure in the core. You know, if we had kept the same boundaries we had in, and I'm going by memory, in 1950, you know, our population today would be 70,000 people. You know, that really doesn't do anybody, even people living in the suburbs like you, any good to have a decaying core. So, you know, you need to augment that with revenue from the outside. What about that argument? I mean,
well,
is that transfer of wealth, if you want to call it that, which essentially what it is that necessarily a bad thing if they spend it properly?
Properly, no. You know, and I agree the city has to grow. And the mayor, in the short meeting that I did have with him, tried to compare us to Detroit, Michigan, mm-hmm. or Gary, Indiana. Hey, I'm from Gary. I was born in Gary. We're not Gary, Indiana.
Well, they have other issues, too, that we don't have.
But certainly. But, you know, my point is I'm not for growth. You know, and obviously...
You're not opposed to growth?
I'm not opposed to growth. Especially when we look at the housing additions uh-huh. to the north. I feel that they could have been brought in. But I really didn't like the way it was handled. And I think the sewer waivers were a big beef with a lot of the mm-hmm. people in our group as well, that they didn't even know they signed them. You know, and for those of you that aren't familiar with the sewer waivers, basically the people that developed the housing addition could have signed for, and many of them did, right. Saying that they would not fight the annexation. That was in the fine.
Essentially, if you're on city sewer or water, you have no right to remonstrate against the annexation. And I think they said about 70% of the people in your area had that waiver, so you really had no way of fighting it in that way.
And, you know, I think that people felt that it was underhanded the way it was set up, because what happened was they waited till the day after the state legislature closed down,
right.
and they waited until they had the percentage of sewer waivers that they mm-hmm. needed, so they could come and say, "Listen, it's over. You're gonna have to capitulate." And you know what? We didn't, because it still had to get through the city council.
Well, you mentioned the day after the legislature, and they made that point the other night. You know, when asked, "Why didn't you call everybody together well in advance, sit down, try to come up with a compromise?" And they essentially said, "Well, we thought if we did that, you guys might try to pass a bill that would stop them." Do you think, is that a legitimate argument?
Well, I don't know, legitimate, I guess, in the eye of beholder, but I mean, we have changed going forward the annexation mm-hmm. process. You know, the the waivers for remonstration cancel after 15 years. And so more and more, and if 60% of the people that have the right to remonstrate say they don't want the annexation, then it doesn't go through. So we've created this, I think, a much more even playing field between citizen and municipality on whether annexation is going to happen or not.
Well, and last year, you all, I think another provision of that law they talked about the other night, that the boundary that they would set now would essentially become the final annexation, at least in, on the north, because anything beyond that would have had to have been voluntary, correct?
I believe so, yes.
So, I mean, you would say it evens things up. I'm sure the city would say, no, you've tied our hands. You know, unless we can get a voluntary annexation, and who wants to pay higher taxes?
Well, you know, some communities around the country, you know, all cities have is voluntary.
Mm-hmm. In fact, most. There's only three states in the country right now that allow involuntary annexation.
Mm-hmm. And I think, you know, the city may say what you said, but I would come back and say it was way too liberal on the side of the city's ability to just come in and take property.
Jeff, do you think the people in your area would have agreed to a voluntary annexation if not for the school issue?
Well, you know, I heard from a lot of the people that lived in housing additions, and they really didn't have a problem with it. I'm not going to say everyone, obviously, but people that I talked to said, hey, we already get city water, we already use city sewer. It's not going to change it. With the property tax caps, it's really not going to change our lives much. You know, we could care less one way.
Many of you are probably already at the cap anyway. So
correct. But you know, the city's argument, and this was a great one. This was my favorite one. One in four taxpayers will not see a tax increase.
So 75%
will. Yeah. Right. You know, I got a kick out of that one. But I still think that the people in the housing industry, sure, are you going to have people that are upset? They're always upset by an annexation. But I think overall, they could have got a large portion of the population, the housing additions, and they would have been okay with it. The big problem I had were the rural areas. If we take out the schools as being probably the primary issue. Other than that, you know, the reason I moved out there, and a lot of people have, is because they want to live that rural lifestyle. I have a shooting range.
Right.
You know, I have 40 acres, which I have set up for wildlife along the river. And just call that the city just didn't make sense. And I think they knew that, you know, at some point.
Well, and they admitted they overreached. But again, because they figured it was their last bite at the apple.
Sure.
They took a big chomp.
It's interesting if they acknowledge that they overreached, but then were unwilling to negotiate.
Well, until the last minute.
That's probably the most disappointing part, to your point, is how it all rolled out, how it was handled. You know, especially looking forward, this is not how annexation is going to work in the future. You're going to have to build consensus and talk with the different units of government and the citizens and make sure everybody's on board, which is how it should be.
Well, let's talk about the politics, because I found it fascinating. I've been a reporter here for 37 years, I think. Never seen the likes of the letter that went out from the mayor the other day, essentially calling the superintendent of Northwest Allen a liar. Now, you know, we could argue the facts, and maybe there was a little fudging on both sides. But it was still a very public confrontation that I'm not sure did the mayor any good in the long run, especially when he came to the table, I think, that very night, looking for compromise. So I'd be interested in your take on the politics of it. Why do you think it was done that way?
You know, Kevin, this is my first foray into any type of politics, so I was new to it. And I'll tell you, we had some fun with it, but one of the things that shocked me was the first city council meeting where it was actually introduced and everyone could stand up. It was open mic night, and the city had a large group of people there presenting the annexation. Right. As soon as it came time for the citizens to talk, all the city employees left. They walked out a back door. They wouldn't even walk by us, which I thought sent a bad signal from the get-go. And the first person to speak was a first grader from Northwest Allen County Schools. And I'll tell you what, he gave a great talk on how he didn't want to cross Coldwater Road and he didn't know how he'd get to school. And I don't see how the mayor can go after the superintendent and say, you know, the superintendent's saying, I'm representing 7,200 children. And the mayor's taking pot shots at the superintendent. You know, I just think that was a bad move unless he'd already given up at that point. And
well, he might have been resigned to it, but as I mentioned, you know, a few hours later, his people came back to council making a plea for compromise, which I don't think that really made anybody all that willing to go that direction. And then Dr. Crawford on council told me the other day, you know, now that annexation's dead, the mayor almost certainly will come back to council and want higher taxes, you know, and you have the option of local wheel tax, local income tax, which may compensate to a degree for not getting the annexation. And now he's called out seven members on council too as not doing their job. And they're going to have to try and, you know, kind of close that out and look for what's in the best interest to the city.
What, I mean, what's that saying though? I mean, we have a spending problem is what it seems like to me. If he's trying to close a budget gap, and it was his budget that passed, if he's trying to close that gap by taking people in the farm community, in the rural community, and in the process, knowing it's going to hurt schools, I mean, I just think, you know, yes, about the politics, that is a huge political mistake.
Well, what about that? And again, I'm to some degree speaking for the city, but they would tell you, look, we've lost, I forget what their number is, you know, millions and millions of dollars over the years because of the tax caps. So, you know, we don't have as much money as we used to spend. You know, and I know Representative Morris the other night said, much as you did, you know, you can quit spending on consultants. Other people might say quit, you know, spending a lot on downtown development, that kind of thing. But, I mean, in fairness, that is a relative drop in the bucket, I think, to what we're talking about. So, I mean, is there really a spending problem? I mean, I would grant you there probably is to a degree. But is it that, or is it more of a revenue problem?
Well, I mean, how long have we had the tax caps, Kevin? I mean, it's been a while. It's not like this is a problem that got sprung. And, you know, property values, they don't increase like the coasts, you know. And so we know the revenue coming in from those. So to me, it becomes that. It's you mentioned earlier, and I've had constituents on Facebook and through email and just personal conversations say, you know, government has to live within its means. And the means is not a huge unknown. We know what that revenue is going to be. And so, you know, the same constituents, they like the idea of downtown development, that, you know, they like the ballpark, they like those things. A lot of people like those things. But we have to make decisions on providing the services government is supposed to provide. You know, I think Representative Morris mentioned at council how some of the annexed parts from past annexation still haven't seen a snowplow. I can tell you, I've lived in numerous different places in Fort Wayne, and I've never had a city snowplow go through. So I would argue we're not even meeting the basic services that government is supposed to meet as a city to the whole city. So we need to check our priorities here. We need to make sure the basics are done. If we have extra, then we look at either tax refunds or doing some of these projects that everybody's excited about.
But I think you would both agree, and speak in a minute, Jeff, the cost of providing government is not static. I mean, there is a certain level of built-in inflation. Even if you take out salaries, I mean, you have infrastructure ages, needs to be upgraded, all of that. So, you know, saying live within your means is great, but, you know, what are those means? And to a degree, they're uncontrollable. I mean, you can plan for them, but even then, things happen.
You know, you asked about the political point, and a couple points I'd like to bring up. One is the week after this was announced, the city comes out and talks about a new arena they're going to build in Fort Wayne.
You know, bad timing.
It was extremely bad timing. It put a bad taste in a lot of people's mouths, saying all of a sudden, now, a week after we announce we're going to annex, we're going to build this new arena that nobody, you know, really knows about or how much it's going to cost or anything. But the second point, getting back to the political negotiations, the mayor's office, and I never understood this, played such a hard line right up until the end. And then they said they wanted to negotiate the Friday before the vote last Friday. So he called the councilman in. The councilman come into the meeting, and the mayor's not even there. You know, and I think that upset a lot of the councilmen, and may have played a hand in their vote on Tuesday.
Well, and he wasn't there Tuesday night either. And I know one of the people speaking pointed out that Superintendent Hemsel was. All of you obviously were, but the mayor was not. He had his people there, and you know, they took one for the team. But yeah,
they sure did. They took a big one. I felt sorry for several of them up there.
Exactly. Well, we have about 5 minutes left. I'd kind of like to turn it to the future. Do you see your group, Jeff, remaining involved in some way, or was this a one-time shot?
You know, we actually talked about that, and we discussed it. And, you know, we may actually start our own political action committee. We've got a nice group of people that are landowners out on the north side, and we're very interested in maybe getting more involved in politics. Not me, maybe individually, but us as a group, you know. And so I would look forward to that in the future.
What do you think would have happened had they approved it? I know you had talked to lawyers about a possible lawsuit. Do you think you would have followed through with that? And if so, what kind of direction might you have taken?
We didn't look into it too deeply. There are some lawyers in Indianapolis that specialize basically in those sewer waivers, and we're told the sewer waivers, the document has to be perfect. Mm-hmm. And if it's not, there is room to get that overturned. I know that the state Supreme Court has upheld them a couple of times, but there's a new group of people in there.
Right, and there's a pending case. I think you had a brief filed too that may address that to some degree. And then moving forward, I know Dave Long, the president pro tem of the Senate, would like to get rid of them entirely.
Yeah, because people just don't feel good about it. It's not fair, you know, when they don't even understand that they signed this waiver. And I talked to several people that were forced into signing the waiver saying, you have to go on to city sewer or your house is going to be condemned, which I find strange.
Well, yeah, they've done that with the, I think, the Regional Water and Sewer District. If you have a malfunctioning tank, or even if you don't, if enough people in your neighborhood sign up,
right,
you can be compelled to get on,
right,
and then you sign the waiver, and there you go.
I mean, down the road, though, to answer your question, what would we have done? We would have probably gone to court to a certain extent. But then my other option was, because it's so important to me and it is my lifestyle, I would have sold and moved at some point. And I think a group of us would have done that as well.
Well, and I think I heard a few of your cohorts as they left the building Tuesday saying essentially, well, it's a good thing they voted it down, because if they hadn't, we'd have voted them out. So I think you probably would have morphed into a political
Certainly.
Action group had it gone in that direction.
Certainly. The councilmen were very well aware of our views.
Well, Martin, I know we talked a little bit about it, but if you had your way come January when you reconvene, will the state in any way make it easier or harder, or take essentially no action to make annexation change?
Well, I think a lot of the provisions that we've changed in the last couple of years is a good spot to be in. And so as that continues to kind of play out, I think we're in a good spot. I think that's why the city was trying to take, you mentioned, it might be our last annexation. Mm-hmm. Well, that's because of these laws that we've changed. I think we're going to see a much more balanced approach in the future, where citizens and municipality are going to have an agreement.
Do you worry, and I know they made the argument from an economic development standpoint, that, you know, if you're not a growing city, you're not as attractive to industry, jobs, young people, all of that. Is there any logic to that, do you think?
Well, I think so. I mean, I think to attract people, you have to be attractive to come. But I mean, whether it's considered city limits or it's county, mm-hmm. I find that kind of hard to get how a business couldn't just see the county as well. Mm-hmm. Also, a big part of economic development, a big part of where people live, a big part of companies when they look at a city is the school system.
Correct.
And the school systems. And, you know, Northwest is a great, Southwest, Fort Wayne, for an urban mm-hmm. district, we do a great job in Fort Wayne, mm-hmm. Community Schools. And obviously we have the Catholic and Lutheran and mm-hmm. charter schools. We have a lot of great school choices in Northeast Indiana, in Allen County. And I think that is a big picture mm-hmm. item that maybe got overlooked.
Yeah,
by
In fact, Tom Smith, a friend of mine, former city councilman, he always nags me to put it in the paper, so I'll give him a free plug here. But his point is, you talk about quality of place, but if you hurt the schools, you're not really doing that. You're hurting the quality of place and making it less attractive to would-be residents.
Right.
So there you go. Well, we've got about a minute left. Any wrap-up either of you want to make?
I certainly would like to say I really wish we could have worked a little bit more together on this. I think if the city would have included perhaps our group and been more open with the city council to sit down and talk about this maybe a little bit ahead of time, and then as the process was going, I can tell you we felt very locked out of the process, you know, and our only way to voice our concerns was in the media and through the city council members.
Well, and hopefully, you know, if they don't reach out to you now, you can reach out to them and find ways perhaps moving forward you can cooperate. So with that, I think we have to end it. But Martin Carbaugh, Jeff Fusey, thank you both for joining me. And thank you for joining us on Fort Report. Be sure to check this and other episodes out at www.news-sentinel.com. Thank you.